an abstraction and a very small module, very trivial module to show how it would look like. So the first thing is, as I said, understanding what is safety. And basically, safety means non-defined behavior in your program. In C, as you know, you may have undefined behavior, which means memory safety issues. For example, you can have a pointer in C where you write into an address that you don't have permission to write to. You may self-fault. You may overwrite your own memory, for example, your own stack, et cetera, et cetera. You may have double freeze, out-of-bound issues, et cetera. So all these things is what Rust is trying to attack. Those are issues that are called undefined behavior in C, and Rust also has that concept. And what Rust offers is non-undefined behavior in the safe subset. There are some conditions to apply here. This is true, but there are some conditions that we need to uphold, and this is what we will see today and in the examples. So undefined behavior, for those of you that don't know, again, is in the C standard is defined as use of a non-portable or erroneous program construct or erroneous data for which the standard does not say what the compiler has to do. So it may do what you are expecting to, but it may also do something completely different. In plain terms or in easy terms, it means if you invoke undefined behavior in C, if you are, for example, you have a data race, it means that your program may do anything. And the optimizer in particular may change your code completely to do something you are not expecting. So that, with that out of the way, I have to explain what is a safe function, what is an unsafe function, and we will also see what is a safe code and unsafe code. And I will put these colors in the slides, where blue, each color will represent a different thing. And we will have four colors, basically. Two, blue and red for safe function and unsafe function. And we will also have orange and a cyan colors for the safe and unsafe code. And these concepts are orthogonal, as we will see. So the first thing we have to understand to write safe abstractions for the kernel and also for any other project, really, written in Rust, is what is a safe function. And a safe function is simply a function that, no matter what the context or what are the inputs to the function, for example, the parameters or the state of the program, it doesn't matter any of that. The function cannot trigger undefined behavior. And a safe function, and we will see examples of this very soon, which will make it much more clear, I hope. An unsafe function is the opposite, is a function that is not safe. And in Rust, you prefix these functions with the unsafe keyword. You can forget about the pink color. I use pink here to show that it's a keyword, but I will not, it's not one of the important colors. Basically, the important colors here are safe and unsafe. And you will see why I'm using colors a bit later. So safe functions, to try to make it clear. There's a question, I think. Let me see. Okay, yes, let's go to that question later. So the first thing is, because sometimes it's not easy to understand what all that means. But for example, imagine that you have a pointer. We will see an example where you have a function in C that takes a pointer. There are many functions in C that take a pointer, right? So you have a function that takes a pointer. This, normally, if you use the pointer, for example, you dereference the pointer, you perform a load or a store in memory, normally, you don't have a way, in most cases, in some cases you may do, but in most cases, you don't have a way to establish whether the pointer, for example, is valid or invalid. You may, for example, test the pointer, for example, you may test it against null, so against zero, for example, but that doesn't tell you whether the pointer is valid. Unless you follow a convention in your program and you are very, very strict on not having any pointer that is not zero invalid, then testing for zero is a good way to test for a pointer, but it's not really covering all the values that are invalid. So it's just like a way to see if it is really, like, if it is zero, then for sure it's invalid, but if it is not zero, then you don't really know if it's valid or not. So a safe function cannot take a a pointer, like an unrestricted pointer, let's say, and point anywhere, and then you cannot give references. If you do that, you have to consider what the caller of that function has to do. When you call that function, this is all C, right? We are not talking about Rust yet, so we are in C, and we are passing this. We are passing a pointer to this function. When we are doing that, the caller is the one promising that the pointer is valid, because the function will just take it. There is no way to test whether the pointer is valid or not, so the function will take it and then it will use it. For example, it will, as I said, it will write, for example, some memory through the pointer. But there is no way to test for that. So we are trusting the caller to pass a correct or a valid pointer. So a safe function cannot do that, because a safe function, what it's saying is, you cannot have any precondition. A safe function cannot have any precondition about, for example, pointers, but the validity of pointers. We will see again, to try to make it that clear. On the contrary, an unsafe function, going to the bottom of the slide, an unsafe function has safety preconditions. So for example, an unsafe function, you can say to the caller, look, the pointer that you are passing has to be valid. And this is all basically is what we do in C all the time. In C, every time we pass a pointer, in most cases, or virtually all the cases, in practice, everything that takes a pointer, a function that takes a pointer, is unsafe in C. Again, not in all cases, you can create examples where this is not the case. For example, if you just take the pointer and you don't dereference it, but normally if you take a pointer in C, it's because you are going to dereference the pointer. This means the function has a precondition, even if normally in C we don't write it, but it has a precondition. Another way to put it, again here, is in terms of contracts or preconditions. Some people prefer to say contracts instead of preconditions. We talk about the safety contract. So a safe function, again, has a safety, does not have a safety contract. So a safe function, it may be a bit shocking or counterintuitive, but a safe function, what is promising is that there is no safety contract to uphold. So the caller, does not have to do anything in particular. It can pass whatever values it wants, that the function will not trigger unfair behavior. While unsafe functions are the opposite. Unsafe functions are expecting the caller. They need the caller of the function to pass various values. Hopefully this will be more clear later. So an example to try to make this clear, not with pointers, but with something else. With a division by C. If you know a bit of C, which I guess all of you or most of you know, division by zero in C is undefined behavior. There is no reasonable value to give, and actually some hardware faults or traps. The C standard says A, as we see here, A divided by B. If B is zero, this is undefined behavior. The program may do whatever it wants. And actually, the optimizer can use this fact to basically infer that after this line, or after this call to this function, then B was not zero. Because if it was zero, then it would have been unsafe behavior. So this is an unsafe function. And I said, UB is produced, if you want, is produced for any call to this function where B is zero, right? There is also another case, for those of you that know a bit more about the standard or the integer arithmetic, which is if you pass the minimum of the integers and minus one, the result cannot be represented. And therefore, basically it's an overflow, and therefore it's also undefined behavior in the C standard. So these are two cases. And this is C. It has nothing to do with Rust. I wanted to start with this because I think it's a very, very simple example to start with. And I always use this example for this. Now, what is a way to make that function, similar function, make it safe? So one way, or the trivial way to do it, of course, and in this case is how Rust actually does it, but not in all cases. One way to do it is for B zero, before we do the division, we test if B is zero. And if B is zero, we do something else. In this case, I simply put abort, panic, however you want to call it. You just stop the execution. In this case, you will not trigger undefined behavior. We also test for the other case. And therefore, because we have covered all the cases of undefined behavior that we have here before in this slide, because we are covering all the cases of undefined behavior, then we don't have undefined behavior. There is no way a caller of f, there is no way a caller of the function f can trigger undefined behavior. Because if you pass, basically you have to think about all the combinations of parameters or arguments, all the combinations of inputs to that function that may produce any undefined behavior in all the possible execution flows, if you want. You also have to take into account, for example, if you have several threads, you also have to take into account data races. If you have, for example, global state, for example, a static variable in your file, and that variable, for example, is the b. So instead of having b as a parameter, you have b as a static variable or a global variable or something else, or external variable. If that b is zero, then you also have to take care of those kind of things. So it's not just the arguments or the parameters; it's also all the context of the where the or the execution context, if you want. So we have talked about unsafe and safe functions. And some people think safe and or unsafe, a common misconception is that safe and unsafe in Rust is this only single thing. So this is only a single concept. But it's not actually true. There is two different concepts. There is also the unsafe for code. And this is also very important to understand in order to understand the rest. So and here's where I start to use another color. And this other color represents the different concept. We will see later how they relate. So unsafe code is code inside an unsafe block. An unsafe block is that it's a block that we will see that has the unsafe keyword. But that's we can just define it easily like this with nothing else. Safe code is the opposite. It's code that is not inside an unsafe block. This means it's default in Rust. In Rust, if you write code and you don't do anything else, it will be safe code. And well, I have to define unsafe block. As I said, it's just a block of code, basically braces, which are prefixed by the unsafe keyword. So unsafe code or code inside an unsafe block, it has access to all operations, basically all operations in the language. Everything you can do in the language, you can do in unsafe code. And that's basically it. That's what unsafe code is. While safe code, you can say it's a subset of the other language, of the unsafe Rust language. So you have the unsafe Rust language, which is the bigger one, and then you have safe Rust, which is a subset of that other language. The operations that it cannot perform is just a few of them, and we will see a couple of them, but it's not really important to describe all the possible things. I have put here two, which are the most obvious, which are one is calling unsafe function. And here you see I put red color, and red color here means the other concept, not the unsafe code that we are seeing in orange, but the unsafe functions, which is the red unsafe. Again, you have unsafe code, which is the code that is inside an unsafe block, and you have unsafe functions, which are different, which are the ones that have a safety contract, as we saw in the previous slide. Another thing you can do in unsafe code, but that you cannot do in safe code, is dereferencing raw pointers. So you have a raw pointer. A raw pointer is what we call in C a pointer. It's exactly the same thing. So in Rust, dereferencing a raw pointer, you cannot do it in safe code because the compiler cannot prove or cannot guarantee that a pointer points to anywhere value. So here in this slide is very short. And I try to summarize and try to remove a common misconception. Also, when one is learning Rust or one is learning these concepts, it's very common to basically mix these four colors or these four concepts together. Or if you want, the concept is just one and the opposite and the other and the opposite. So in reality, it's two concepts. It's just that one is safe function, unsafe function, and safe code and unsafe code. So to try to get the point across again, safe functions, the ones in blue, may or may not contain unsafe blocks. An unsafe function also may or may not contain unsafe blocks. So they are completely orthogonal. And actually in the language, if you use the language right now, as it is in the current, current and the previous edition that exists of Rust, It is true that unsafe functions by default imply an unsafe block in the code, but in the kernel we don't use that. There's also quite a few people that is trying to argue to separate completely the concept, so not have this implicit unsafe block. So we will assume here we don't have that because this is a talk for the kernel, so we will assume when you write an unsafe function, you actually have to put unsafe the orange one. You have to put unsafe still, so it's not implicit. And we will see if you have some experience with Rust or you have seen Rust, it's easy to tell or it's easy to, I think the easiest ones to understand are unsafe functions that do not have any unsafe code, and also unsafe functions that have unsafe code. Those are the two combinations, basically, of the four. These are the four combinations that make the most sense. So for example, you see here, well, the samples I will go later. In the four quadrants here, we see in the top left, safe function with only safe code. This is the one that I said is an easy one to understand, and we will see why. Then we also have in the bottom right corner, we have the unsafe function with unsafe code. And these are also easy to come up with, basically. But the other two are a bit more complicated to understand. Safe functions with unsafe code, it's also easy to see, and we'll see an example. But the one that is most hard to understand or to see an example for, and I will have to take a bit of time on that one, is the unsafe function with only safe code. So let's start with the four examples. And if you understand these examples, I think you will understand this concept. And basically the rest of the talk and the rest of your Rust course and learning Rust will be much, much, much easier. So a safe function, the blue color, with only safe code, the cyan color. We see here the function is trivial. If you know C, basically you know what is this function is also doing. If you don't know the Rust syntax, this fn means function, f is the name of function, x is the parameter, i32 is an integer of 32 bits long. The arrow means shows the return type, which is the same. And then the braces implementation. We don't use return. You can use it, but it's idiomatic in Rust not to put return for the return of the function if it is not the first one, basically. So this function basically adds one to the number and returns. As you see here, there is no unsafe. There is no unsafe keyword anywhere. And therefore, we are in the safe part of the language. We are in the safe subset. And the function does not have either an unsafe prefix. So it's also a safe function. But this is clear. This is the most basic example. And I think everybody can understand this right away. So let's go with the other. The bottom right corner that we saw in the other slide, the quadrant. Unsafe function with unsafe code. So here we have function. This is the one that I was describing in the beginning of the talk. It's a function that takes a pointer and returns the content of the pointer. So it performs a read or a load of the pointer and returns the value. Okay. And I put here in red and also in orange in the code to show you the difference and to try to make the difference very, very clear. So unsafe, the red, means the function, and unsafe, the orange, means the code. And again, as I explained, this is a pointer, p is a pointer to star, meaning pointer, const means the same as in C when you pass a const int pointer. So the contents of the pointer are constant. You are not going to store anything in the content. And we have a question that I think, yes, it's relevant. So I will answer that one. I didn't know whether to go into that one. Let me see. So I click on Q&A or, okay, I will read
that. I can read that for you, Miguel. There is one question in the chat that might be more relevant on your previous slide.
Yeah, that one.
You're showing adding plus that, but x plus one can result in overflow if x is the max value. I had the same question, and then several people have the same question.
Yes, this is a very good question, and people that know C are rightfully asking the question. It makes perfect sense to ask the question. In Rust, overflow is not defined to be UE, and therefore can be used in safe code. So basically, plus one will not be UB. So in any case, whatever the value is of x, plus one will not trigger UB. there are in Rust, there are different ways of you have different ways of performing wrapping add, saturating add, etc. There are different ways. I don't want to go into that. UV is undefined behavior. Sorry if that was not clear from the beginning of the talk. UV, when I say UV, I mean undefined behavior. Basically, undefined behavior, as we said, if you don't have, I'm reading the chat, sorry. If you don't have, if you have undefined behavior, then the program can't do anything. Okay. So
why is that? One more. I think we need a little bit more explanation probably for people that think and see, like me. Mm-hmm. Why is it that overflow is not an undefined behavior? Because this, you could have this value overflow as such.
Yes. That's basically a decision of the language. They could have designed the language with arithmetic, being basically integral arithmetic being UV, and therefore in that case, we would need to put the unsafe braces here as well. But they defined, because it was, I guess, the rationale was that it was so common that defining the integral overflow to be UV, like in C, would not, basically would be, mean that many places in code would have unsafe. So they defined overflow not to be UV. It still is considered an error in the language. Mm-hmm. So right. if you have overflow in integers, it's considered an error. And your program should not have overflow. And actually there is a compiler flag or a compiler mode, and in the kernel you can enable it. There is an option in the kernel hacking menu that we have to enable checking for that. So we can actually see where overflow happens if it happens. Of course, there is still all these things, and with the examples we will see later of the kernel, is still up to debate whether we should enable that flag always or not, whether we should even have the option to begin with. So I don't want to say we want to enable it or not. Some people in the kernel want to enable that flag for Rust, others not. Some people argue that this is all new code, so we can right away enable the flag and keep it on forever. But the answer is, even if it is an error and it's considered an error, in Rust, it's not undefined behavior. So yes, that's a very good question. There is also another question. In safe code, is overflow statically analyzed by the compiler? No, it's just in the there are two modes. In the mode where the compiler is not checking, it's like in C, except it's not undefined behavior. If I'm not mistaken, it will always wrap, but it will not be undefined behavior per se, even if it is considered a mistake. And in the other mode of the compiler where it will check at runtime. It's not a static analysis.
There is one in the question and answer box. Isn't passing in reference in Rust the same as pointers in C? Would you like to answer that now?
I can answer quickly. It's I didn't want to get into references and everything because it's very long and we will need to get into a lot of the Rust language. But there is three, or if you want to, let's simplify. There is two pointer types in Rust. One is the raw pointers, which is what we call C pointers in C. Plain pointers, raw pointers. And then there is the references. And references come in two types, which are the ser references and the mutable references, or the unique references, if you want. And the other ones are called, so it's a share or exclusive, depends on who you ask. You can see them in both ways. And then there is the mutable or the unique references, unique in some way. I said wrong. And mutable and exclusive one, and the other one is the share or, not unique. But references are used precisely, references are introduced in language precisely because pointers in Rust are not, and in C, there is no way to, as we were discussing before, there is no way to test whether a pointer is valid or not, and therefore you have to introduce another concept. And the concept Rust introduces is references, and those are guaranteed by the compiler via the borrow checker to be valid where you use them. You cannot construct every single possible program that you can construct in C when you are using references, basically when you're using safe code with references, but nevertheless, you can still construct most of the code that you care about. And in the kernel, even if we have to use unsafe code, as we will see later in abstractions, you can still use references, you can still use the other things, and you don't need to use pointers so much. So we will see that we have, you can see in the kernel, because we will not go today into pointers, et cetera, but you can see in the abstraction in the kernel that we have right now, we wrap, for example, take a file, extract file from the kernel or extract mutex, and we have a pointer to the raw pointer to the C extract, so the one that is defined in C, and we use it like that, but we don't expose that pointer to the drivers or to the modules or to the clients, however you want to say it, okay? And that way, basically, we are hiding the raw pointer and providing a safe API so that the clients can be safe code. Are Rust references similar to C++ reference? Yes and no. Yes, in the sense that, for example, they cannot be null. You cannot just have an invalid reference. Having an invalid reference in C++ is UV as well. But in Rust, references come in two flavors, as I said, the share and the exclusive ones or the mutable ones. And then you have as well the lifetimes associated with them. So references come with a static lifetime. So it's not a runtime lifetime, it's a static lifetime. And the compiler and the borrow checker uses that to ensure that the reference is valid. So it's similar in a way, but it's different in other ways. So yeah, I would basically all Rust references, C pointers and C++ references are all pointer-like types, if one, or pointer-like facilities, but they are different. You should not map completely one to the other. I see compile or runtime panic. I will have to open that. We can perhaps go, let me see the questions in the chat. In practice, how is overflow trapped? If not, you will get UV from Eric. They just check the operation. For example, if you divide by zero, they will, if you see the in Godball, the output, you will see that they test for the, if the compiler doesn't know, if the optimizer knows, for example, that the B is not zero, it will not put the runtime check there. But otherwise, that's just how they do. For, again, for overflow, for other things like the validity of the references, the Rust references, this is not a runtime. This is done at compile time. So it depends. Basically, here we can go on and on, but basically for some things, Rust prevents UV, undefined behavior, via runtime checks, and other times it prevents it via compile time mechanisms. So it depends. It depends on which is the case that we are looking at. So plain integration is defined to wrap, but it's up to your program whether it should be considered an error similar to... No. In Rust, it's considered an error. And there are two modes in the compiler that you can use, up to you, up to your project, depending on what you need. But as far as I understand, it's considered an error and your program should not overflow. But it's not undefined behavior. So the optimizer will not go crazy assuming that overflow cannot happen. That's the difference. Okay, so let's try to go back a bit on the safe function with only safe code and the other examples, because again, this is the please ask more questions about this, because it's the perhaps not the hardest part of Rust to get or to understand, but it's the key one that you have to understand to be able to write safe abstractions and understand why some things are safe and unsafe, and how to wrap things, how to model your subsystem. If you're a subsystem maintainer, how to model your subsystem to make it safe. So, perhaps I should have used here not plus one, but another operation that, so that we didn't have to go into the overflow discussion, but yeah, let's assume that it's an operation that is a trivial operation. Okay, or just imagine that I return just X. So there is no discussion there. It's just an op, and it returns the SD identity function, and it returns the same X as we have passed. And then we have the other one that we were saying, the unsafe function with unsafe code. And this is, we pass a pointer and we dereference the pointer. And because the P is unrestricted, if you want, if P can have any value, whatever the caller wants, then when we dereference P, we have to trust the caller. We are trusting whoever put the P there, the argument. And therefore we have to, because we trust the, because we are trusting the caller here, we are trusting that the caller is putting a valid pointer, we have to write unsafe in red. So the unsafe in orange here is only because the language makes explicit where when we are in the superset or in the unsafe Rust language, if you want. So inside those braces, we are allowed to dereference a pointer. If I try to remove the orange color here, the code will not compile. Okay. However, the red one is something that I am promising. The red one is not something that is checked by the compiler. The red one is something I am saying, is something that I am telling the compiler, this function is not safe. This function needs the caller to check for the arguments. The programmer needs to be trusted, basically. The caller has to be trusted. There's a question not really related, but I will read it. Could you overwrite a function, basically a safe F and an unsafe F? No, you cannot overload. In general, you can do operator overload in Rust, but there is no overload in Rust, apart from that. That is how you write a safe API for a safe section of code, etc. So let's continue. So these are the two, I hope these two are basically clear, the two different ones. And we will go to the other two quadrants, which are a bit more tricky to understand. This one is a safe function. The one in gray with the background is a safe function with unsafe code. So blue with orange, right? Here, to make it the example simple, I have copied the previous slide. So this is the function F. I have renamed it to function J. And I just call it from F to the other one. But the one I'm talking about, the safe function, is the one in the bottom, the one in the highlighted with the background. And what is happening here is, as I told you before, the function in top is unsafe, and I have to write, I have to in the sense that I if I don't do it, it's a bug. Okay, we can go into that later. I have to write the red unsafe. Otherwise, it's a mistake, and we will see what is the name of those kinds of mistakes. But in the bottom one, I am not writing it. In the top one, P is basically unbounded or not unbounded, unrestricted if you want. But in F, I am passing here the syntax may surprise you. It's basically like the address of this literal. So it will create some place where it can create a pointer to the literal. It's just that. But the key here is that F, even if we are performing, we are just calling the other function, which is unsafe, F is safe because we are passing one pointer that we know always is valid. And there is no way outside of F, any caller of F, there is no way they can manipulate that, or they can try to break that to introduce undefined behavior. Okay, so let me see that. There is a raised hand. If you want to.
Yeah, Faith, would you have your hand raised? Would you like to answer your question? Ask a question. You can also put it in chat or question and answer box. You can go ahead. Miguel.
Okay, so I hope this one is clear. I will repeat, I will leave it here a few more seconds. The top one is unrestricted. The parameter is unrestricted, and therefore we have to trust the caller. And F is passing a fixed, if you want, a fixed pointer, a pointer to 42, wherever that may be. And we know that operation, calling calling the other function, the top function, is unsafe, as we saw. Calling an unsafe red function, basically the red unsafe, calling one of those functions is an unsafe operation. And therefore, we have to be in the unsafe subset of Rust we have to use the orange unsafe to call it. But since we know there is no way the caller, we don't have to trust, basically the caller of F can do anything. We don't have to trust the caller to avoid undefined behavior here. So F is actually safe here. Okay. And now the last one, which basically to give any meaningful example, I have to introduce quite a bit of code. I will try to summarize what all this means. But this is the case, the last quadrant, which is unsafe function with only safe code. So we have a module M. These are the outer braces. We have a module M, and inside we have a struct definition, like in similar to C. Pub means public, means public in Rust. It means that people or programmers outside this module can access it. Also, basically, even outside the crate, but let's not go into that. Basically, we have a struct, a definition of a struct, and the struct has a pointer inside. Basically, the same kind of pointer, a pointer to a constant inter. And we have imp. Imp here is basically it's saying the implementation of S is a way to add methods if you want to a struct, but that's not. Please don't get to. Let me see the chat. It doesn't scroll. Yeah. So implementation of S means adding methods and static functions as well. Constructors, etc., etc. New here, the first of the three functions that we see here, new is a constructor, is what usually we call constructor. Actually, there is nothing really special about the new. It's not like C++ constructors. New is just the normal name or the idiomatic name that we give to this function. And new, you could say it's like a static method in the sense that it doesn't take a this pointer like C++. It doesn't take any parameters. Not even hidden parameters, let's say. And it returns S. Self here is basically a synonym or an alias for S itself. So it returns an S. And the S it returns, which if we go into the function, in the implementation, we see it returns the same thing we were seeing in this other slide. We create a pointer to somewhere that there is a 42. And we return a struct that has P initialized to that. And then we have two functions more. These are methods. These are methods because they take the first parameter. If you see the at mute self and the other one, the reference function has a at self a parameter. These are explicit in Rust. They are not explicit in C++. This will be similar to the this parameter in C++. One would be for mutable, one would be for like the non-const qualified. This pointer in C++ and self would be for the const qualified. So basically, the reference is a function that cannot modify S in a way, and the mutable one is the one that can modify S. Okay, self is the name of this, like in this in C++. It's a reference to the receiver if you want of the call. And then the other parameters. And the other parameters here are for set, are P, which is basically we are doing a set. We are saying, take this pointer and assign it to the structure. So we are just overwriting the pointer. We don't do anything fancy there. And the reference, that's the reference that we saw in the other example. So this is basically an example that I crafted with the concept that we already saw in the other examples. But the key here is that the unsafe orange and the unsafe red are in different functions. And so this code can perform, basically the people outside this slide or this crate or this module, they can create an S, the S struct, they can create a new one, calling new. And they only, after having an S, they can only perform two operations. One is setting a new pointer into that structure, and they can also dereference it. But they cannot, take into account, they cannot, basically someone outside M, the module M, they cannot perform the assignment of P by themselves. So they cannot, P is private to S, so you cannot, from outside this module, you cannot overwrite P. So with that in mind, with those rules, more or less, I hope they are make a bit of sense. We can now hopefully understand what is going on here. So first of all, the reference in the bottom, if you compare here with this function that we saw, we are dereferencing a P, right? And we said we have to write, the programmer has to write, this is an unsafe function. This should be red, the red unsafe. We should write red unsafe because we are performing something that that we are trusting the caller. Here, we are not writing the red unsafe in the reference. So this is a safe function. We saw one example of this, a safe function that contains unsafe code. The question is, why this function is safe? Because we have a set in our methods, and we can basically, the caller or the client of this struct can control this pointer, right? So it may be shocking to say, no, this is a dereference. If the caller can control this, then it should be also unsafe. But the key here is that set, the set itself is unsafe. So we have here a function that does not perform any unsafe code, copying a pointer or assigning a pointer from one place to the other, which is copying and basically copying the value of the address. There is nothing special going on. There is no safe, there is no unsafe orange unsafe in the set function. And this is what may be shocking. And that's why we have to construct basically this example to show one example of this kind of function. Now you may say, so how does it work? A caller, how does it work? So why it is safe? Basically, I'm declaring or I'm saying that this module M is sound, is correct. It's a module that you cannot, no matter what the caller does, no matter who is calling this or using this S, let's say that, it doesn't matter what do you do with S, there is no way you can enter this undefined behavior. And the reason is that if you, imagine that you create a new S, imagine that you create a new S with new, the pointer is valid, right? So we know that at that point, the pointer is valid. Then, if we dereference at that point, we also know that the pointer is valid because we didn't call set, so the pointer is still valid. This will not introduce undefined behavior. And if they call set, set is unsafe, it's red unsafe. It means we are trusting the caller to give us a value of P that will not introduce undefined behavior. But not just in this function. And this is where the key part comes. The safety boundary, as they say in Rust, the safety boundary basically where you have to enforce safety is not at the level of a function. The examples we have seen here, they are just functions, basic free functions, and they are simple ones, right? Actually, in Rust, the safety boundary, you enforce it at the module level. So because unsafe, because set, the set function is unsafe, and this is in the same, is in a module, the callers outside this module, they have to be trusted to put a correct P value there. Okay, I hope if you can see why this is the case. So if we trust, basically, if we can trust that every call to set is a correct one according to a safety contract, or we will see how to document that. If we have a safety contract that says P has to point to a valid value, then no matter what they do after that, if they still call the reference will not enter the undefined behavior because the set call was correct. Correct in the sense that they didn't put a P that pointed, for example, to none. Okay? So this is basically an example of an unsafe function that contains only safe call. And this is used, you can use it in modules, you can use it to create different kinds of abstractions. When another point of the safety boundary being the module in Rust is that all the code, not just the code in the implementation of S, all the code in a module in Rust can access the private fields. So imagine that set and the reference were not methods. They were outside this imp S braces. If they were outside, they would still be able to access the P field because they are inside the module M. If they were outside the module M, you cannot access the P field. And this is why you can construct, you can basically craft functions, safe and unsafe ones, in such a way that no matter what users of the module, not of a functional type, but users of the entire module, no matter what they call, with what arguments, you have to ensure they are not going to introduce undefined behavior. But what you can do is trust the ones that you mark red and safe. So if you say you put red and safe in a function, then you are saying, I trust you, and I hope you are basically, you have to, if you don't do that, I don't promise anything else. If you pass a pointer here, P, that is null, then the other functions that are safe, I don't promise anything. So it's a conditional promise. The safety promise that you are giving is this S type or this module M, if you want, is will remain, will not introduce undefined behavior as long as you play by the rules when you call set and any other unsafe functions that you may have. Okay, so this is the most basic example trying to show both the safety boundaries in Rust and also an unsafe function that does not have actually any unsafe operation inside it.
Miguel,
and someone is asking, so yeah.
There's a question in the chat box.
So if I understand this correctly, the dereference function is safe because the unsafe set function provides a contract that the users have to abide by. Yes, that's correct.
So that's how correct. Is this?
I don't speak here from, in order. Yeah.
How is this different from, say, in C, if you have a function that says, I expect a valid value pointer and it doesn't check? Is that, isn't this similar to that?
If a C function says this pointer has to be valid, actually most functions that we were saying in C normally, I mean, it doesn't need to be the case, but normally when a function in C takes a pointer, if it's going to dereference it or to save it so that it later dereference it, which is virtually basically all the cases, unless, for example, you just print the address, for example, right? Or you just, I don't know. But in general, when you pass a pointer into a C function, it's basically implicitly is unsafe. So all the functions in C are unsafe red. It's the red unsafe we have there.
So I understand that. I understand. And it is. It gets very complex if you look at structures, right? If you have a structure and so the structure itself, the main pointer might be valid, but a embedded pointer might not be. So it gets very complex. I understand that, the unsafe part. But what I am struggling with is, why would you, what is the difference between this? This is an explicit contract in Rust. How is this different from an implicit one in C that says, well, hey, we expect valid pointers?
Well, the key here is that when we have these rules and having the compiler enforce that you cannot call, for example, unsafe red functions, unsafe functions, you cannot call this set if you are in the safe subset, right? So the key is that when you are outside of M, which for example is a subsystem, think about M as a subsystem in the kernel, right? When you're outside M, every client of M, as long as they remain in safe code, they will not be able to cause undefined behavior. So for example, if you have a driver and your driver is completely with safe code and your abstractions are correct or sound, as we will see, it's basically the you can use both words, then there is no way a driver could introduce undefined behavior. So for example, if you review, you receive a driver and you don't see any unsafe orange, then you can say, okay, you are worry-free in the sense that at least the driver will not introduce a vulnerability related to undefined behavior, memory safety, data races, et cetera, et cetera.
Right. So, okay, I get it. Yeah. So essentially the compiler is watching out for you in,
yes,
if you were to. Once you say this is the contract, the compiler ensures that contract is enforced, if you will.
It ensures that you cannot call such a function from safe code, but it will not check that, for example, P is valid because it's a raw pointer. There is no way you can still pass to this function null. Okay, you can pass it if you are in unsafe code in the client and you pass null, then you're breaking the contract. So unsafe means The programmer is responsible for ensuring the contract. For the rest of the code that is not unsafe functions, not unsafe function, I made a mistake here. Not safe, unsafe code, so the orange unsafe. For those, for that kind of code, the safe code, there is no way you can write any kind of code such to do it so that you will introduce undefined behavior. So put another way, if you imagine that you have a malicious programmer, you have written a library or a subsystem in the kernel, it doesn't matter, and you have you give this library to a programmer, and you are basically with Rust, what you are saying is, no matter what code you write, so not actually the inputs of a user, so even a malicious programmer, the one using the library, what you are promising is, if you have done the job correctly and the abstractions are sound, what you are saying is, no matter what you do, as long as, no matter what you do in safe Rust, no matter what you do in safe Rust, and even if you mix it with unsafe Rust, as long as those unsafe calls respect the contracts I have written, then you will not be able to introduce undefined behavior. So if there is any way you can use this module M to introduce a memory safety issue, for example, overwrite your stack, let's say. If there is any way you can overwrite your stack with this module M, then this code is incorrect and it's considered a bug. And the key is that, the key of this is that it allows you to analyze the code locally, in the sense that I can give this module M to other people, and I can more or less reasonably, when I perform the manual basically analysis, trying to understand whether there is a way to introduce undefined behavior for callers, I can analyze M on its own, right? And not only that, but it's also another layer of defense for undefined behavior, because as long as callers stay in the safe subset, or even if they use unsafe function calls, so they use an orange unsafe to call set, we only have to review those calls, and if those calls are correct, then the rest of the code will not introduce undefined behavior. So it's basically a way to reduce the places where we actually are responsible, programmers are responsible for not introducing undefined behavior.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I hope, I know it's a bit abstract to think in these terms. I hope with when you start to use it, it's much easier to see the benefit, because in C, when you program in Rust and then you go back to C, basically you are always in unsafe. It's like in C you are in a big orange unsafe block, and basically you're responsible for every single line that to see whether or not it introduces undefined behavior. If I go back, for example, to this function, the plus one, I know just by looking at it right away, I know there is no undefined behavior here because there is no unsafe orange block going on. So it's very, very easy to analyze this code in with respect to undefined behavior. Of course, you can still have logic bugs, et cetera. Okay. I hope you can go through the slides offline, and I hope it makes more sense. So what happens if I will have to be a bit quick. What happens if we make a mistake? So if a safe function is not actually safe, the blue safe, then it's called unsound, or you can say incorrect. This is considered a bug. It's not something that the compiler, again, the red unsafe, or not writing the red unsafe and making a mistake there, it's not something that the compiler is going to enforce. There is no way the compiler can know whether here, this function, for example, there is no way, well, some trivial cases, it could know, but what I mean is that in general, there is no way for the compiler to know what is going to be, if your module is completely sound or not. So you are responsible for writing that unsafe in red if you actually have a contract for your function. But if you say this is a function that is safe, but actually it's not safe, so there is a way to introduce undefined behavior for callers, then that is what is considered a bug, and in the standard library of Rust, a CVE is assigned. Even if there is no software published that actually exploits the vulnerability, or even if there is no, for example, imagine in a image library in C, you have that reads PNGs, for example, and you pass some pointers to this library. Normally, just a function that takes a pointer and dereferences that pointer is not a vulnerability or is not a CVE. you are supposed to pass a valid pointer that, for example, the library may have given you in another function. For example, an analog function, you get a pointer and then you pass it to the other functions. So that's not that is not considered a CVE in C. But in Rust, if you have a function and you allow to pass an unrestricted pointer like here in your library, even if the user is supposed to pass the P that was returned by another function, that would be unsafe, because if you don't put the red unsafe, I mean, because there is a way actually to trigger undefined behavior here. It's as simple as passing F null. Calling F with null does undefined behavior directly. So even these cases are considered a CVE. So promising that a function is safe and not actually being safe is considered a bug, and a CVE is assigned in Rust. And sometimes when you see these CVEs in Rust, these are the kinds of CVE they are talking about. When you see an unsoundness issue in one of the CVEs, these are the kinds of bugs they are talking about. So it may be the case that actually no user of the library has actually realized any vulnerability. Okay, so it's like an extra layer of defense, if you want. And this is the example. Is the other function. I just removed the red unsafe. So this is unsound. This is a bug if you write this function. It will do the same. The function will do the same. It's not that it will do something different. The compiler will not treat it differently. It's just that it's a bug because a caller can introduce a different behavior with it. So there's a couple of misconceptions I want to go through quickly. Some people think safe functions cannot trigger UV. This is, yeah, normally, let's say, normally this is true, but there is this condition we just spoke about. That's why this is incorrect. Safe functions should not be able to trigger UV. But if there is a bug in those functions, for example, then they are unsound and this is considered bug. So it's not true in the sense of they cannot, in the sense of there is a formal guarantee or a guarantee from the compiler that you will not be able to introduce UV. If the functions that you marked as safe have a bug, then they are unsound and they will have the callers will have a way to introduce undefined behavior. So it's not that the compiler is reviewing every implementation of a safe function. What the compiler is promising is another thing. What the compiler is promising is, if your safe functions are sound, that means if your safe functions do not have any bug like this, then what it promises is that if the caller only uses safe code, they will not be able to introduce any undefined behavior. So it's a conditional promise that the compiler is giving you, but the safe function has to be actually safe. Otherwise, the compiler will not be able to prevent anything. Another misconception is unsafe block means UV will necessarily be produced. And the point here is, the fact that you have an unsafe block does not mean that UV will happen. In fact, actually, you should never, never have undefined behavior in your program. It doesn't matter unsafe blocks or not. This is completely different. UV should never happen. The only thing that an unsafe block gives you is the ability to use operations that cannot be checked by the compiler for UV. And therefore, basically, the responsibility is on you to not have UV. But you still should not have UV. It's not that, because some people I have seen online that some people basically map these two things. Unsafe is UV, or unsafe is related to UV. And actually, no, a UV, you cannot have UV. This is the same rule as in C. There is no difference here. And coming back to the kernel a bit, let me check the chat quickly. So unsafe code pushes responsibility to the programmer, otherwise in safe code compiler has our back. Yes, unsafe code, the orange unsafe, pushes exactly the responsibility to the programmer. When you use the orange keyword, you are responsible. When you write the code inside those braces, you are responsible, like in C, exactly like in C. When you are in the orange unblock, unsafe block, you are responsible for not introducing UV, just like in C. That means you have to, every time, for example, you dereference a pointer or you call an unsafe function, you are responsible for going there and checking every single contract of the function to see you are not introducing UV. That's why also, normally, and in the kernel, we follow this guideline, this coding guideline. We reduce the size, not the size, the length or the scope of the blocks, of the unsafe blocks. We reduce them to the minimum possible, or as reasonable, basically. We don't have like a big function with a single unsafe block, because then you are back to C, basically. You are not getting any benefit. The idea is that we reduce them to the minimum possible. And actually in the guidelines, as we will see in the example very, very quickly now, we will see that we write a comment explaining why this operation, for example, at the reference of a pointer, why this is guaranteed by the programmer, by us, by the comment. It's not a formal proof, but it's still an explanation why the programmer that has written that line of code thinks this is not going to introduce UV in any case. Someone else says, as for me, it looks like as a warning that, hey, the result of that function can be UV, rapid with unsafe and write checks. I'm not sure exactly what that means. It's a warning in the sense, you can say it's a warning in the sense that when you see unsafe red, that's an unsafe function, then you know you have to uphold the contract. But since you have to write the orange unsafe to be able to call it, the compiler will not allow you to call it by mistake. So if you stay within the safe subset, you don't have to worry about mistakenly calling one unsafe function that you didn't know it was unsafe, for example. If the caller is using an unsafe code to call a function, but the only way to know if the contract is violated or not by the caller is at runtime, but compare how is UV prevented? Well, you have to know always. This is exactly like in C. If you don't know, if you don't know whether you are preventing UV, the program is basically broken in a sense. At least the same as in C. If you have, for example, a program that receives some inputs, and you don't, Thomas is saying, I think my question was explained with your statement, what you do in unsafe code block is programming responsibility, let me see. Yeah, okay, thank you. Okay, I will go a bit fast. Yeah, okay, you're welcome. So in the kernel, the safe and safe split, the split is referring to I put these colors in the title, but could also be understood with the other two colors as well. But the split in general is the safety split, the safe parts and the unsafe parts. The goal in the kernel is to write drivers in safe Rust, the cyan Rust, and here is the cyan one because it's basically not having unsafe blocks, and ideally having the 100% of that. Sometimes we may not arrive to that point. For example, there may be some cases where we cannot, we have not found a way to make an abstraction safe and performant enough or fast enough. Sometimes you need an unsafe because you want to really, really skip a check or you want to use something that you statically in the sense, not the compiler, but statically the programmer. Statically, the programmer knows that there is no need for a check and there is no way to reasonably abstract that at the subsystem or the abstraction level, and therefore you just write the unsafe in the driver. The point is trying to not do that. The point is to write the drivers in safe Rust. And to keep also not just the drivers. It's easy to explain with the drivers, but even if you have several subsystems, the because the safety boundary, as we explained, is in the module, the different subsystems can use each other sometimes, or they can be clients of a common library, for example, something like that. They can also use this. For example, if we have a common kernel in the kernel slash something, we have a common facility in the kernel for something, the subsystems using that facility, they can also be, for that part, can also be safe. So it's not that all the abstractions are completely unsafe either, but it's easier to see it more with drivers and the subsystems. And then calling the C side of the kernel, I say here, requires an unsafe block. This is to explain that the bindings to call the C side of the kernel needs an unsafe block. Because in C, we don't have the concept of safe or unsafe. We don't have a way to mark this is not going to give undefined behavior no matter what. So anytime you call a C function, it's understood to be unsafe, okay? And that's why the reason we are hoping in the sense we enforce it. We don't enforce it with a tooling check, but we hope we will be able to do that soon. To remove every single call to the C side and force drivers to go through the abstractions. So you should not write a driver that calls the bindings. In the example code that we will not have much time to go through that there today, but I have uploaded some code I will show. And I try to show both ways of doing it. And I hope you will see the advantage of the good way and the, compared to the bad way. So basically having no abstractions compared to having the abstractions. Yeah. The other one, sorry, if you can put the other link, the second one, please. So here is an explanation of data driver. In the left side, mostly or ideally we'll use only safe functions that are written in the kernel crate. The kernel crate, this may change in the future, but the point is the subsystem or the abstractions. It doesn't matter that it's a single crate or it's a lot of crates. We have subsystem that provides some, for example, a GPIO IO subsystem that provides some safe functions, and hopefully the drivers will be able to use to be written only with safe functions or with the minimum possible unsafe calls. So that basically reviewing a driver is very easy. But then the subsystems will use unsafe calls. They will use unsafe orange because they have to make those calls, and they will use unsafe functions coming from the C side. Okay, and that's why we here in the bottom part we say forbidden. We are for we are trying to forbid, or we are hoping that we can enforce this like statically and strictly in the kernel, so that nobody from a driver calls the C binding directly. And that's why we are doing this. It's not that we are. Do we want to write abstractions? Is that we think there is a lot of value in writing abstractions and making this safe abstraction. Okay. This is also, we will skip this. This is a bit to explain a bit of the crates. So the setup very quickly so that you you can play with this if you want. These instructions that you will see here in the slides that they will share, Swa, Megan, they will share these slides. These are basically instructions that apply today, but since we are changing things and things, the abstractions themselves and everything, may change in the near future. This is all experimental in a way. Please always follow the latest that you can find for your for the checkout of the tree that you have done in documentation Rust Quick Start. So the setup, you can check out the Rust branch in the in this first link. This is where development is happening. And the second one, I created a mentor branch with an example, very, very trivial example code that we will see now that you can play with if you want. So that you see basically all the pieces coming together, but very, very simple. It's very simple. It's not like a real driver or anything like that. Then there is the LLVM toolchain. I explained here that you have to, preferably, you should use the LLVM one builds. Clang should also work. I mean, Clang, the compiler, and not the rest of the toolchain should work. The GCC builds work in some configurations, but this is very, very experimental. It's basically a hack that we have in place for the moment. So if you really need to use it, go ahead and use it, but it, there are maybe some configurations that do not work at all. And in our cases, even if you want to use the GCC builds not to install LVVM, for example, please note that you need libclang installed in your system somewhere, a recent enough version of clang and libclang. The Rust toolchain, I saw here in the slides how to install it. There are several ways in the documentation that you will we explain how to install this this toolchain. There is ways to verify the signatures, etc. But here is basically the simple one, the one that is recommended by the Rust language, and is quite straightforward to install. Just you click enter, you install for whatever. You can also choose which target to install, etc. You also need after that, you also need to install the standard library sources because we have to compile for the kernel target that we are using. We have to compile core, which is the very basic, or not the basic, but the things that do not depend on an allocator or on an operating system. We can read more on that on the split of the standard library in Rust between freestanding and the other ones. And it's just this command. It's very quick. Then you install Bindgen. For installing Bindgen, you use Cargo. It's the only place where, well, that one and the tests, but it's the only two places where we need Cargo right now. And Bindgen you install like this. You put Cargo install locked version and it will download the code and compile it. So the example subsystem I wanted to show, and you can read more about it offline, perhaps we don't have a lot of time, but I created a driver's mentor folder. It's a key value store, provides a few addresses. I will explain this as we go. This is the header. Very, very simple. This is the entire subsystem, okay? Basically, we have a public interface that consists of two functions, a read and a write, to an address, which is just an integer here. It's just an address conceptualize it in some way. The valid address is go from 0 to 5. Accessing any other address is considered UV. So for example, imagine that this is not an address, an integer, but it's something else, and we will dereference something, or we will read something else. Is let's say it's considered. If you so I can answer that about the recording later, perhaps. Yes, the recording will be uploaded, I think. So there is two functions. One is pure C, let's say, and the other one is a macro, as we have in the kernel many macros. So it's just a macro. It doesn't make sense here in the example, but it's to show you that sometimes we have macros in the kernel, and we have to call these macros from Rust. And then we have a private part, a client should not use. For example, this mentor read, that is the one that the macro calls. The underscores don't see here too well, but if you are zooming the slide, you will see the underscores. The macro mentor read calls the underscore mentor read function. So this is our subsystem, and we want to write we want to use it from Rust, right? So we have, the first thing we have to do is create the bindings. The bindings are Rust code, it's just Rust code, the declarations, if you want, of the C functions, so that we can call them from Rust. And we can do this by hand, but we could do it in particular. Thank you. Thank you, Waising, for showing that. So it's just Rust code, declarations of C functions, but instead of doing it manually, right now we put the list of headers that we want to use from Rust. This will probably change, but for the moment we just have a list in this place, in this file, and we just include the headers we want, like here, and it will automatically be called, bindings will automatically be called by the build system, by pbuild. Then, for things that bindings cannot really reasonably map to Rust, for example, the mentor read was a macro, and it was not like a trivial macro, it was not a constant, for example. So we actually need to invoke the macro in a C file, and then call that function. This is a, if you want to say, it's a bit of a cumbersome process. If we really have Rust in the kernel, probably we will want to have, instead of having these helpers here, perhaps we will want to have this as real functions in the C side. But for the moment, we keep them here, not to pollute the other parts of the kernel. It's a small file so far. But we will have to address this. But for the moment, you will have to put in this Rust helpers.c file, this function, and you have to prefix it with this Rust underscore helper so that the whole mechanism works, okay? Because there is a bit of magic so that it basically creates the binding with this name, and it will pick that name. So this C file is just invoking the macro so that the C compiler takes care of the macros, and we can call this helper from Rust. So now, writing a Rust module very quickly, this is boilerplate. I don't have time to explain everything, but the module exclamation mark that you see here is basically the same things that we do with the module underscore description, module underscore author, et cetera, et cetera, parameters, blah, blah, blah. Everything is done with a single macro invocation like this. So we hope that this way is simpler than in the C case, but this is basically how we are doing it right now. The other things are not important. The use part is like an include, and the other things that you see in the top doesn't really matter. The feature and noisetd doesn't really matter, and we hope we can remove that in the future. So an implementation, and I don't have time to go through this one, but you can read it offline. This would be an implementation without a safe abstraction, which basically breaking the rule that we have, or that we want to have, of not calling the bindings directly. So as you see here, there is this orange, if you try to see the orange, if you look for the orange, or unsafe blocks, you will see that we are doing actually calls to the bindings, to the C function. So this is a direct call to the C function. So we want to avoid that. And it means that if we do this in the bottom, I say there in the command, we can produce undefined behavior just like in C, because at this point we are not really gaining much. It's true that outside those unsafe blocks, this is safe code, but still you have to basically review every single of these unsafe orange things, and you don't gain anything. You don't gain anything inside those blocks. It would be like calling the function in C. There is no difference. So how do we write a safe abstraction? Boilerplate here, the abstractions are, all the abstractions or the subsystems, if you want, are currently in Rust kernel. This also may change in the future. In the top part, we see a couple of definitions. We see a function that is called isValid that just compares with the addresses that we have, so that we know whether an address is valid or not for our subsystem. And the important part is this. There is a read function that we have created in this abstraction of the C subsystem with the documentation and everything. So I have to mention several things here. One is, first of all, the documentation looks like this. This is Markdown. It's I think fairly easy to write. There is some conventions to follow. We try to follow these conventions. We try to follow several of them. We try to do things similar to the standard library in Rust. There is, for example, you can see in the top part, you can see square brackets with the backticks, read total writes. This is a link that will be automatically, by the documentation system, will be automatically picked and links to the, like, for example, in Elixir bootlin, if you have used a LXR or a cross referencer, that will be a link automatically generating the documentation. So you can click there and you don't need to put any link, it will be automatically done. The example you see a symbol in the beginning, a hash, that means it's hidden, that part of the example, because only the only interesting part for the people reading documentation is the one that doesn't have that. And the key here is that, as you see, we have used a trivial way of trivial, or in this case, maybe depending on what you are doing, it may be the only way of doing it or not. Here we check first the address. And then if the address is not valid, we return an error. You see here how we return errors in Rust. And otherwise, we return that the address is valid. We return that the function was successful, and we perform the read. Or explain better, we perform the read, and then we return the wrapped result of the read in an OK value, which is basically one of the variants of the result. And the key here is that the coding convention is that we write this safety comment in uppercase. This safety comment is what we write before every single orange block, okay? Before every single orange, basically before the gate of going into the unsafe language, we write this safety comment. And we explain why we have, we think this code is, thank you, Omega. We explain why this call is safe, or this call is sound, sorry. So why there is no way, because the read, the Rust function is safe. We have not written the unsafe read. So this read, whatever address it takes, it cannot trigger undefined behavior. And if we don't have this if conditional, if we don't check that, then we are passing the address directly, like if it was a pointer, and then we will trigger undefined behavior. In the example code I have uploaded, where you can play with this, basically, I instead of triggering undefined behavior, I just write in the log, you have triggered undefined behavior. But a very, very simple, like the most trivial example of how you could prevent undefined behavior is like a runtime check where you can. If you can do such a runtime check, in many cases, you will not be able to. Sometimes, if, for example, if you use pointers, pointer-like things, you will have to use references in Rust, etc., etc. But this is like the most simple example I could think of. If we remove, so the point is, if we remove the isValid check, this must be an unsafe function. Otherwise, it would be unsound. Because address is not restricted, and therefore there is no, the caller of read can put anything there. The write is similar. I will not go into that much. Then we have another one that I separated. You can see more in the example. Is that I separated the addresses that were writable and the one that was not writable and was only readable, etc., etc. It's just an example. Then you can create a documentation. I saw this because it's very simple, and the documentation is key for the last part. It's very, very important documentation, because we have to provide the safety contract. For those functions that are unsafe read, we have to write an unsafe safety section, and those we really need to do, because otherwise there is no way someone can actually verify everything. And while in C, sometimes it's implicit and you have to check the implementation. In Rust, we are trying to, it's not that we are trying, we are doing it. Sometimes we are currently, there may be some missing, but the point is that we are following the convention, the same as in the Rust standard library, where we have to put a safety contract in every single function that is unsafe. And similarly, we have to put the orange, for the orange blocks, you have to put the safety comment, which is different, which is different from the safety contracts. The same is the same distinction as the safe and safe function and safe and safe code. It's the same. We have the safety contracts for the functions that are unsafe, and we have the safety comments for the orange blocks for the actual operations that may introduce UV. So generating the code, the documentation is very easy, and I hope you like how quick it is. There is no need to install the spins. There is no need to nothing. You don't have to install anything else. It comes from the normal Rust distribution. And the documentation, if you look into the generated files in Rust / kernel Rust doc right now, it will look like this. So your documentation will look quite nice just with few, not much effort. And the read total writes, as you saw there, is clickable. And the examples look like that. So it's quite nice, I think. Then the test, you can write tests, something trivial like this, where we check the addresses, whether they are valid, we assert or not that they are valid, and then you can run these tests. Right now, we only run the test in the host, so there are some limitations that you have to know which kind of tests you can run or not, but in the future, the idea is that we have all the tests, so basically the same as the self tests and the key unit tests, everything in the same place. So the overhead of the FFI checks, there is no checks for the FFI. The calls are exactly like in C. There is overhead, for example, you have to call a macro, and the macro in the, for example, there is no inlining right now. There is no cross language inlining right now. It's supposed to work, and I think we can make it work in the kernel. But right now it's not working the cross language LTO, so there is no inlining. If we make that work, I think the overhead will be much lower. Of course, if you have runtime checks, because you have not found a way to make the abstraction safe in any other way, then yes, you will have some overhead of the conditions. But please know that, and this is key to understand, please know that in C, you also have to have these checks. Perhaps you don't have them in the same place, but you have to have somewhere, you have to prove that you are not introducing UV, because if you have UV, you have a vulnerability or a logic bug or something else. So the not logic bug, sorry. What I mean is it's a bug that corrupts some memory, even if it's not a vulnerability per se. So the point I'm trying to make is you have to have the checks the same, at least you have to have some checks in C as well. So it's not that Rust is introducing more checks. Sometimes it's easier to do that, to make a function safe, but in some other cases, and that's the hard work, is trying to make the abstractions safe but fast at the same time. Let me go ahead. This is how you run the tests. You can see it offline. How you format the code is just that. And back to the Rust module, I put here a slide, and I will finish with this. I put a slide where instead of having, this was the original code where we use the orange unsafe blocks, and with the safe abstraction, it looks like this. So there is no anymore unsafe blocks. So my driver or my module here, I know just by looking at it that there is no unsafe blocks. I know there is no way I can trigger undefined behavior. Again, this promise only holds if the code that I wrote here in the abstraction, all these two functions basically, and the other one, if this code is sound, is correct, then the driver here will not have an undefined behavior, no matter what the driver developer writes. And that's the key thing, and that's why we want to write abstractions and not just call directly the C side. And this is basically the most important thing to realize. The syntax and all other things and the features of Rust, they're important, and there are many things that you have to understand to be able to write abstractions properly. But the key value of Rust that we want to introduce to the kernel is precisely this, that we can write most of the code in the safe subset. I will try to take a couple of questions very quick. Any recommendations?
Well, you have questions in the Q&A bar.
Yes. Yeah, sorry. When I call a safe function that contains unsafe code, do I have to take it on trust that the writer of that function has correctly judged that the unsafe code is being used safely, or does the compiler check it? If you call a safe function that contains unsafe, you are trust, basically, there is two places where someone is trusting someone else. One is you are calling the safe function, there you are trusting that the safe function doesn't have a bug that allows to introduce undefined behavior. The implementation of that function to any other function that it calls is also trusting those other functions. And for the unsafe orange block that you have inside that function, that is you, or you are the responsible of actually making sure, because it's an orange block, is basically it's telling the compiler, I will check this. It's something I have to check because you cannot check it. Okay, so you will have to be responsible for that. Is Rust and Wrap considered safe or unsafe? It's safe because they not, and Wrap doesn't trigger undefined behavior. There is another version that actually I and Wrap is an optional result if you are talking about that one, and I introduced one for the unsafe version or the unchecked version if you want, where you are, you the caller are the one that you have to ensure that the result of the option are the value that you expect. Will binding support GCC in the future? So we have put that in the list of things we want, and we hope in the future, yes, GCC will support, binding will support GCC. So basically binding, we hope that we will have another backend so that we can have complete or full kernel builds with GCC and full kernel builds with LLVM completely dependent. But for the moment, this is not the case. We hope funding or some people or perhaps ourselves in the future, we can take on that that challenge. And two very last questions, how much of effort you need to redefine those constants and basic utility functions? Error imbalance are redefined in C code to be usable inside. So the basic things and the general infrastructure things, we hope that we cover as much as we can ourselves in the Rust for Linux effort, let's say. We are trying to write actual drivers. So many things that you need are covered, but many others are not. For example, if you run to write a GPIO driver, if there is no GPIO abstractions yet, you have to write them if you are the first one doing it. And you probably will have to work with the maintainers first to see if they want actually to take in their tree an abstraction. Would be a concern for increasing the amount of duplicated code in the kernel going on forward? So the first question would be a concern for increasing the amount of duplicated code. We are not duplicating code in that sense. What we are trying to do is duplicating in a sense, but we are not replicating the subsystems or the utilities. We are, as far as we can, not always, but as far as we can, we are wrapping the C side. So we keep the C side the same, and then we write the Rust part that calls the C. For example, mutex. Mutex is we use the mutex from C, but we wrap it in Rust, and you use it as if it was a Rust mutex, but in reality, you are using the C1. And the last, I am a hardcoder, low levels, hardware, software, boundary system programming, primary language is C. What is a reasonable way to start learning Rust? You can go into LPC recordings. We have some introduction of that. I think the Rust webpage is very nice. There is also an embedded book. If you have already read the Rust book, there is also other books as well, and there is quite a lot of resources for embedded. Not much yet, but we hope with the kernel work, we also trigger much more people to start using Rust in low level and embedded. Is there any support or plans to support generating FFIs for C to call Rust? We don't have time more, so the questions keep coming, but is there any support? Okay, this is the last one. Is there any support or plans to support generating FFIs for C to call Rust? There is both. So there is binding that generates the way, but there is also C binding. Yes, I think it's called C binding, that is the other way around. So Eric asked, start with the better Rust book. No, I would start with the official book and then go to the other books. There are books for several topics. I would start with the official book, or the Programming Rust is another very good book on Rust for low level C programmers. And my opinion on memory management, GC between Rust and Golang, I think it's out of scope, but basically Golang or the Go language, there is no way. I don't want to say there is no way, but basically for a kernel, I think Rust is a much better language for a kernel, because it's like C. It allows you to manipulate memory and to manage memory explicitly. There is no GC at all. I don't know if Megan, I could continue. I don't have any problem, but if you have to finish.
Yeah, we are right at